I have to say, it was a really good thing to have the people from Isaiah out here with Representative Lucy Rehm to review what the legislature has gotten done this year. They talked about how the last time they had a trifecta, it was 13 years ago, which is when the governor, the Senate, and the House are all in one party. And they were cautious, and they did not want to do too much. They wanted to get reelected. And of course, that meant that they did not inspire people to get out and vote for them, and so they lost out. It took 13 years before they had another chance. So this time, Governor Tim Walz, the former teacher from the farm districts of southeastern Minnesota, he said, "We don't get elected to gain political capital. We get elected to spend political capital and make something happen." So they did. Their motto this year was, "Let's go." Isaiah had a few highlights that they focused on. An increase in the child care assistance program's reimbursement rates, an investment in the land stewardship projects that won $5 million in state soil health dollars, the defeat of attempts to limit democracy through Jim Crow era voting restrictions, and passing democracy expansion by allowing 5,500 felons to vote again. When felons get to vote, it brings them back into full citizenship. It gives them a stake in keeping a law-abiding existence. Lucy Rehm pointed out that her favorites in funding for public education, free breakfast and lunch for all kids in school. It makes a huge difference in their metabolism if they're not hungry while they're trying to learn. More counselors and nurses on staff in the schools. $17 million in state funding for Eastern Carver County alone. More pre-kindergarten opportunities to engage young learners straight out of the gate. These are especially important now because public school funding has been under attack for decades. There's a major effort by evangelicals to fund school choice initiatives, which means state funding for Christian schools. I have no problem with Christian schools, but our government has no business funding them, funding religious programs like this. The importance of all this is really hit home for me as I was reading the new biography of Dr. King by Jonathan Eigen. King was battling legal segregation and Jim Crow laws. He was battling for better jobs, better educational opportunities, and better housing. And in our own time, we have seen the end of legal segregation, while discrimination and racial violence is still on the rise. We have seen a drop in black unemployment, but no change in black imprisonment. We see better funding in Minnesota for education, while in Florida, the governor there is running for president, and he has ended programs such as the ones that teach AP American history. And when they discount the value of Black history, they are discounting the value of Black people. That's part of how three Black people got murdered in a dollar store. George Orwell said, "If you control the past, you control the future." And Florida's governor wants to eliminate Black people from the political equation by pushing them out of the educational system. I can speak to that especially because the program they cut is Advanced Placement History. I took AP History, which is basically a college-level course that's taught in high school. I learned a great deal of uncomfortable history there. I remember the chapter on the American conquest of Mexico, where we took the rich half of Mexico because we could. Texas to California. The chapter was called "An Empire Disguised as a Nation." And we are an empire, Blanche, we are. There was another instance in Florida of a class on African American history which was canceled because one student was made to feel uncomfortable. That meant that 27 students who were mature enough to study reality got robbed of the chance for a better education. Let me ask, what country should be teaching African American history? It's American history. What states need to be teaching about slavery? Should we say all of them, but especially the states where slavery was legal? Slavery was legal at one point in Massachusetts, Pennsylvania, and New York. And if we tell that story, we can gain that feel-good sense that justice was done when slavery was ended. We rob ourselves of inspiring stories when we avoid the hard news of bad things that happened. This comes back to Dr. King because we just had the 60th anniversary of the Dream Speech, where everyone could see what it looked like to live up to our best potential. The biography takes us down the road of how the movement was made some progress and got some historical legislation passed after a long battle. And then it began to fracture and fall apart as time went on, and as white Christians failed to heed the call, and as black activists became more and more impatient with nonviolent methods. Expectations were raised beyond the ability of the system to change fast enough. Dr. King had long nights of sadness and despair. That's when he asked, "Children of God, where do you stand?" So, where do we stand? I also revisited my own experience of growing up while there was a war in Vietnam. Dr. King had to come out against it, even though everyone was telling him, "Stay in your lane. You're a civil rights leader. You have to focus. Don't rock the boat." But King said, "Wait a second. Black men are being drafted and killed at twice the rate as white men. How is this not about civil rights? How is this not about how poor people without political power cannot escape into colleges and universities and get student deferments like so many white men? How can he preach nonviolence when the U.S. is the most violent nation in the world?" So while King made everyone see where we need to go, the long, slow, painful effort that it takes to make something happen is a story that needs to be told so that we have the patience to hang in there and strike when the opportunity arises. We have to be ready. We have to be poised to take action. Our story about Moses receiving his call from God reminds us that Moses thought God had the wrong guy when he was called. "Me? Who, me? Are you out of your mind?" said Moses. If you read a few more verses, you see Moses tried to talk God out of it. Just like we will try and get out of doing our part because we are only one person. We are not powerful like Moses. The virtues of following our faith tradition include being able to maintain discipline over time, to be committed to the causes we support, even when things look bleak. In the psalm today, the word is faithfulness. Verse 1, "Vindicate me, O Lord, for I have walked in my integrity, and I have trusted in the Lord without wavering. Prove me, O Lord, and try me. Test my heart and mind. For your steadfast love is before my eyes, and I walk in faithfulness to you." And I know the feeling that when we read the words of the Bible that seem to hold up impossible standards for us, we can sometimes feel like Moses. hey, God, you've got the wrong person if you think I can do these things. God knows better what we can do. We have to engage our spiritual imagination and make sure that our faith is part of our calculations, that things can happen that we cannot predict. There's a story in the King bio about he was speaking at an event, and a member of the American Nazi Party named Roy James came up and punched King in the head twice. King did not defend himself. He dropped his hands to his side. Security grabbed James, but King refused to press charges and brought him backstage and said, "We need to pray for him." Okay, that's another astonishing story about King showing us what nonviolence is all about. I don't think I would have had the presence of mind to immediately go into prayer mode for someone who just punched me in the head. Maybe an hour later, maybe the next day. But King had so committed himself to nonviolence that he knew what to do immediately. He blessed Roy James. He did not curse him. So now we listen to this piece of idealism advocated by Paul in his letter to the Romans, the Roman Christians he had not yet met. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to that which is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Sometimes this section of the text is outlined as Paul's encouragement of the faithful to live in orientation towards their own community. Then it's about how to respond to those outside. Verse 13, contribute to the needs of the saints, the poor. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. That's a good one. But take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourself, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine," says the Lord. We have to remember, this is a real countercultural idea. If you look at any action movie, they're all about revenge. So if we're going to forswear vengeance, we're going counter to our entire culture. If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. It sounds beautiful. However, things are not always so clearly delineated, and it would be naively idealistic to presume that persecution, mistreatment, and causes for vengeance occur only outside the boundaries of Christian fellowship. In fact, as recent stories about abuse and misconduct from prominent church leaders indicate, these appeals from the apostle are as relevant for Christians experiencing trauma from fellow believers as for those suffering attack from outsiders. King getting punched by an American Nazi brings to mind the story of how the FBI, under the iron grip of J. Edgar Hoover, went after King with a vengeance, because Hoover had decided King was either a communist or a dupe of the communists. The Nazis in Germany talked the Christian church the Lutherans, the Catholics, the Reformed, all of us, into hating the Jews because they saw communism as a Jewish effort to rule the world. Well, Karl Marx was Jewish, Leon Trotsky was Jewish, but communism was atheist. So any believing Jew should automatically be considered a non-communist, if not an anti-communist. But if all you care about is making someone into a target by sticking them with the label of a dangerous revolutionary, then just call them a communist. It didn't have to make sense or even be true. That's what Joe McCarthy did. It's how Hitler labeled the Jews. It's how Hoover labeled King. It's how right-wing crackpots label Black Lives Matter. People now and anyone else who cares about civil rights are called communists. It's still being used as a trope. And it is easy to say that anyone who opposes me must be a communist because I'm so anti-communist. Hoover spent his teen years in a fraternity that was very worshipful of Southern culture that prevailed during slavery. A culture of comfort and luxury and white supremacy. And he saw any activities by Black political leaders as a threat to society as a whole. Hoover began his work for the Bureau of Investigation in 1919, where he was assigned to ferret out any subversives during World War I. Well, the bad guys were foreigners. Hoover stayed in power for 54 years, long after anyone else in the federal bureaucracy would have been terminated, because he had something on everyone so he could blackmail them. And Dr. King, unwisely, gave Hoover something to investigate. King's weakness was in yielding to the many women who threw themselves at him, just as his father had before him, just as John Kennedy's father did, just as John Kennedy did, and as Kennedy's father did before him, just as LBJ did. That's what men of power did, rightly or wrongly. But if Hoover released this information on King, it would have shown that the FBI was snooping into places it had no authority to do so. So Hoover gave transcripts of all of King's calls to LBJ, even though he could not release them in public. Hoover tried to peddle the stories to reporters. None of them took the bait because they said it's nobody's business. But Hoover made sure that King knew that he had the tapes, because it rattled him and depressed him. When John F. Kennedy was killed, it was a double blow to King and the movement. Kennedy had started the process of getting civil rights laws passed, and so their first thought was, we have lost our best friend. The second thought was, if they can do this to the president, they can do it to anyone. King was with Coretta when they got the news. After a long silence, Martin said, this is what will happen to me. Coretta said, I wanted to say, no, that won't happen, but I couldn't. I knew he was right. King knew from then on, 5 years of facing death every hour of every day, but he remained faithful. Paul's letter to the Romans was written before the Gospels were. We read the New Covenant backwards that way. I always thought Paul had the Gospels and he read them and got inspired by them. But we now know that Paul's letters are written about 50 to 55 CE, and the Gospels are written from 65 to 110 CE. So maybe Paul's writings were inspiring for the community that was going to give birth to the Gospels. And as such, it is the good advice of a devout Pharisee that we read. And we read it so that we become better people. We read it so we become better citizens. And we read it on the off chance that God has something in mind for us. And we need to be ready when the moment strikes us. even if it strikes us in the face. Let us pray. Dear God, who has given us the word upon which we can build our lives, bless us with a furious patience to shape the future of ourselves and our worlds. Help us to envision a place where we can turn away the anger of those who feel like anger makes you right. And bless us to keep our cool when others around us are losing theirs. All this we ask in your name. Amen.